What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In today's video, we're going to cover one possible implementation of maps. Actually, two implementations. One of them will try to solve the collisions using chaining, and the second one using open addressing, and in particular, linear probing. If you have no idea what the hell I am talking about, make sure to watch our video about maps and collisions, linked in the description below. Let's start by creating our hash item class, or whatever you want to call it. This class will store the key value pairs we need to insert in our array. It is needed for both implementations, whether we are resolving the collisions using chaining or open addressing. But as you can see, in case of chaining, this class requires an additional field, and it is the next hash item in the list. As we mentioned in our previous video, when a collision occurs, the items will be stored in a linked list, in case you are using chaining as our collision resolution technique. And a linked list is basically a bunch of nodes, each holding a reference to the next node in the list. And the nodes in our case are none other than the hash items themselves. The addData annotation you see is a Lombok annotation that will generate setters, getters, a constructor, and a toString method for our node. If you have no idea what Lombok is, make sure to check our Project Lombok video here on Geekific. Now, with the hash item out of the way, let's go ahead and try to implement the hash table or map class, and let's start with the chaining implementation. As you can see, this class has the array of hash items as a field, obviously, and the size field to keep track of the items we are storing inside our map. In addition to this, you may have noticed a static final int variable called maxMapSize. It denotes the maximum number of buckets the array can hold. In case of chaining, we do not need to resize the array, so this number will remain intact while we insert and remove items from our map. In our constructor, we are initializing the generic array. By the way, always try to keep your classes as generic as possible. And if you are not familiar with the concept of generics, do not worry, we also have a video covering all you need to know about them. Now, before we start to go through the actual implementation, the last method we have here is the hash method, which in our case is nothing fancy, as you can see. All we are doing is calling the native hashcode Java method on our key object and then applying modulo 5 on it. 5 being the maximum allowed size of our array we just talked about. Now, to insert an item into the map, we have the put method. This method takes as parameters the key and the value we want to insert. The first step is hashing our key, always. So we hash the key to obtain an index, and then check if there is already a hash item sitting at this index. In other terms, check for a potential collision. If the item we just retrieved is null, then we do not have a collision. Let's consider for now that this is the case and we do not have a collision. We will have to insert this hash item as if we are inserting an item into a linked list. So we wrap our key and value with the node, which is the hash item here. Then we insert the newly created node at the root of the linked list, which is stored inside this particular index, the one we obtained using our hash method. The root here is none other than the top element at this index. After doing this, we increase the size of the items stored to keep track of them, and that's it. Now, if the item we retrieved is not null, and we do have a collision, then we have two cases. First, the key already exists, and what we are trying to do is not inserting a new value, but instead updating the value of an existing key. Or, we just had a collision, and this new value should be added to the linked list stored at this specific index. In code, we will have to loop over the items stored inside this particular linked list and check if any of their keys matches ours. If we have a match, then an update should be performed. And if we do not have a match, we should let this while loop finish and proceed to the code block following it, which is the block we just wrote. It will insert an item in the linked list of that hashed index. Now, what if we want to retrieve an item from the map using a given key? First step is always hashing the key to retrieve the corresponding index, and next is retrieving the root hash item corresponding to this key. However, because we are using chaining, the root item may not be the one we are looking for. So using the next item reference, we have to loop over the hash items stored inside the same index. And by comparing their keys with the one given to us, we are sure to find exactly the one we are looking for. This piece of code is actually pretty similar to traversing a linked list or retrieving a node by value from it. Okay, what about removing an item from this map? First step is, you guessed it, hashing the key, then retrieving the root element of our linked list at the corresponding index. But here we do not only need a reference to the item we want to remove, but also to the one preceding it in the list. Why? Simply because we are removing an item from a linked list, and to do that, the next node reference of its previous node should be updated to point at the next node of the item we are removing. If you don't quite follow here, I suggest you take a look at our linked list implementation video, and everything will become much clearer. Next, in this while loop, we are doing exactly the same thing we were doing in the get method. We are trying to retrieve the exact hash item we want to delete by key, while trying to keep track of its previous hash item in the list. This while loop will only execute if the root hash item we found at first is not null, because if it is null, it means that the key provided by the user is invalid, hence a null should be returned. And that's what's being done here in this if statement. We return null here because simply our hash function could not find any hash item corresponding to the key given to us by the user. On the other hand, if we did find a key, we should take into consideration two cases. So the key found which matches the key given by the user is either 1, the root of the linked list, or 2, located at middle of the list, or in other terms, is not the root of the list. Because if it is at the middle, the next reference of its previous hash item should be linked to the next hash item of the one we are trying to remove. And if it is the root, we just set the new root to be the next hash item of the current root. Again, watching the linked list implementation video will make all these notions much easier. Finally, we decrement the size of the items stored inside the map and return with the value deleted. And that's it, the hash table implemented with the help of chaining. Let's move to the probing implementation and start with the hash table class. First, notice that the capacity of our array maximum size is a variable here and not a constant, because in case of probing, we may need to resize the array, as we are constantly searching for new available slots to store our hash items in. And this private constructor that takes the capacity as parameter is actually here to help with resizing, and that is why it is marked as private. The default constructor, the one with no parameters, is here to help instantiating our map. As you can see, inside this constructor, we start off the array with a capacity of 5, similarly to what we had in the chaining implementation. And last but not least, the hash function is exactly the same as the one we previously had. To insert a value, the first thing we do is not hashing actually, but checking if the array has reached a total capacity of 75%. And if it has, we double the capacity of the array using the resize method. And after resizing, we hash the key to retrieve its corresponding index. Now, similarly to what we did for chaining, we have to check if the key already exists to perform an update, or if it doesn't, to perform an insert. And that is exactly what we are doing in this while loop. The insert is straightforward here, as we are using linear probing with a probe of +1. All we have to do is add 1 to the index and modulo it by the capacity. After an appropriate slot is found, we go ahead and insert the hash item we created into the array. The final step, of course, is incrementing the size by 1. Before proceeding to the remaining map operations, let's check the resize method we just made use of in our put operation. Pay close attention here, that while resizing, you have to use the put method on every hash item again, one by one. You can't just copy-paste the arrays one into the other, because the keys have to be rehashed. If the keys are not hashed, then the get and remove operations will not work, as all map operations are based on a single thing, and it is retrieving an index based on the hash function. If we go ahead and copy the items mindlessly from one array to another, nothing will guarantee that the index we chose to assign to these values corresponds to a valid output for our hash method. So, in this for loop, we have to check every item in the map, and if this item is not null, using the put method, we insert the new hash items into the new map. After this, we update our array to be the newly created one and set the capacity to be the new cap defined. Now, the get method couldn't be any easier. We start by hashing the key, then, if the retrieved item is not null, using our probe sequence, we keep updating the index until we hit a match. And when we do find the requested key, we return the value of the hash item associated with it to the user. Okay, the remove method is a bit tricky, so pay close attention. First, we hash the key, of course, and loop over the array and attempt to find the hash item we are trying to remove. When we do find it, we store its corresponding value in a variable to be able to return it to the user. Then we set the array at this index, where the key was matched, to null, and we decrement the size. Okay, cool, but there is something missing. And before implementing it, let's take this set of key-value pairs as an example. And suppose that all these keys map to the same index, or in other terms, they collide. If you are using the same probe sequence we just implemented, they will be mapped one after the other using the plus one probe based on what was inserted first. So the first one will go in index 0, the second one in index 1, and so on. Now let's go ahead and remove the third key, the one stored at index 2, which is 20 in our case. Okay, fine. Now I want to get or retrieve a value that is after this key in the array. Let's say the one stored at index 3, so the key 50. As you already know, to get a value, the first step is to hash the key. And we said that all the keys are hashed to index 0. Now, because we are using probing, we have to keep incrementing this index by 1 until we hit a match. But wait, while looping, we are going to hit the null value we set when we removed the value stored at index 2 before having the chance to find our 50, which means the get method will assume that there is no match for our key in this map and will return a null to the user. But we do have a match. How can that be possible? Deleting a value without rehashing the keys that come after it until another null value is hit is what caused this issue. If we want to find the value corresponding to both 40 and 50, that is what our map should look like. And that's the part that is missing in our remove operation. So let's go ahead and implement it. This is done using a while loop. We have to start from the next item in the array, and while we haven't encountered another null item, we have to remove all the items that come after the element we just removed, and then call the put method on them to allow these elements to be rehashed just like we did in the resize method. We are also decrementing the size before each put call, because inside the put method we are increasing it again. This way we will keep a correct count of the items stored inside the map. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching, take care, and I will see you in the next one.